Well, after all the discussion about confessions and penance recently, it's important for us to recall, what's the point of all of that? Why again are we doing all that penance? It's about love. Confession frees us so that we may love as we should. That is the purpose of life. And there is no greater means of growing in love than devotion to the Sacred Heart of Jesus. And so since we've seen how to start freeing ourselves from sin, which holds us back from that love, let's look for a while at the love that we're after. Today's sermon will just be an introduction to devotion to the Sacred Heart. It's taken largely from St. Alphonsus's writings about the Sacred Heart. Jesus Christ, says St. Alphonsus, is so faithful to those whom he calls to his love that we must have the utmost confidence in obtaining all that we desire and the certainty of our salvation. Is it possible that he who has called you to his love will somehow fail to bring you to the completion and perfection of his love in heaven? He is faithful and he is all-powerful. And he loves us. In fact, he is so faithful to those whom he loves that we may hope for everything from him. And how can I say we? We may hope all things. How do I know that you and I have been chosen by him to be loved and therefore to be saved? Because here we are. He does not call those whom he does not love, and yet you and I have been called. Called to baptism, called to the one true faith, and called to be here today to hear these words of mercy and love. All we have to do is accept that love and that mercy. It doesn't matter how unfaithful we have been ourselves, nor does it matter how little we feel that we love Jesus, nor even how little we feel that we want to love Jesus. We've been called. And it's no mistake that you are here today. No one is so wretched that God cannot love them. And because we have been called, if we choose, the beatific vision is ours. Eternal life, knowing God face to face, living with the angels and saints forever, with no possibility of losing that life. It's that simple, because God has chosen to love us. If we've locked God out of our hearts, we need only open that door. He's standing there waiting to enter. If we seek certain blessings and gifts, all we have to do is ask in the name of Jesus. And we've been promised that we shall obtain every blessing that we desire. He is all-powerful, and he loves us. If we're tempted, we have only to trust in his strength. And no enemy can approach us, nor in any way gain a victory over us. Men can lie, or promise more than they can deliver, or change their minds after they've promised. But not Almighty God. He is all truth, all powerful, never changing, nor is he changeable. The Canticle of Canticles tells us, that love is strong as death. An interesting phrase, love is strong as death. Just as nothing created can escape death, so also nothing can escape nor resist nor conquer love. Love is a tower of obsidian. It's a rock that cannot be broken, cannot be moved, it cannot even be scarred. It's the very fortress and the strength of the Creator of the universe. Not only does love create, but love also moves a sinner from sin to the state of grace. And that is more power than the power to create the universe. And God is love, says St. John. This is why God cannot fail in his promises. And he's promised heaven for those who will love him. But so that we will not fail in this bargain, we know that God cannot fail. But we know that we can. so that we will not fail, God also promises to help us love Him if we will seek to do so. God Himself will save His people, says Deuteronomy. Not only will He love us in return, but He will help us love Him. Now the heart is a human organ, and by it we refer to love. When Jesus revealed to St. Margaret Mary Alacoque the love of His heart, He spoke in human terms, as we speak. We know what a heart is, and we know what it means to love. But what does it mean for Jesus to love us? Surely all that it means for us to love, Jesus is truly a man. All that we mean by love is included. But Jesus is also God. And the actions of Jesus are actions of both God and man. He has two natures. A nature, as Frank Sheed so cleverly explained, answers the question, what? The nature tells us what a thing is and therefore what it can do. A bird has a bird's nature, and so it can do things that birds do. A man has a man's nature, and since it has the nature of a man, it can do the things that a man can do. It can laugh and cry and think and pray. And God has the nature of God, and thus He can do what God can do. Create, cast out demons, walk on water, know the future, and pretty much anything else. But the word person answers the question, who? It's not my nature that laughs or cries. It is I, the person, who does those things with a human nature. In most persons, there is one nature. But in Jesus Christ, there are two natures. And this is a great mystery, but God has told us it is true, and so we know that it is, because God can neither deceive nor be deceived. And since it is true that there are two natures in Jesus Christ, all the actions He performs are both human and divine. He, the divine person, the second person of the Most Holy Trinity, walks on water. But that action is not merely a divine action, it is also a human action, because the one performing it is human. Well, what was the point of all of that, nature and person? Jesus Christ showed us His Sacred Heart in order to give us confidence. He showed us His human heart beating with divine love. Until 2,000 years ago, God did not have a heart. And now He does. It's a human heart. And for all eternity, He will have that heart. And that heart has a hole in it where it was pierced. And it poured out blood and water so that we may love and so that we may live. That is God's love reflected in a human heart. A heart that is also divine. Divine love is many things. And to speak poetically, it's a fire that inflames the heart as earthly love can only imitate. It's light for the soul and a fountain that always satisfies. And it's a cool dew that refreshes the soul and makes it grow. And it's a quiet repose where we find perfect peace and security. It's a perfect bond between our souls and God, causing Him to dwell in us. It's a treasure containing every possible good, and yet it's still worth more than the whole universe. It's hotter than the fires of hell and cooler than a spring. It's as high as heaven and as low as our own souls. It's as brilliant as the sun, but beautiful to gaze upon. And it's a perfect chain which binds us to God, but it's also perfect freedom. The Canticle of Canticles tells us that love is strong as death. St. Alphonsus says that just as no created power can resist death, so there is no difficulty that love cannot conquer. In fact, this is how love is tested, by the difficulties that it can overcome, by what it's willing to suffer for the one it loves. And so the saints were happiest when, by human standards, they suffered the most. Love is strong as death. No matter how great a sinner we may be, our miserableness and our wretchedness are not sufficient to stop God from loving us. And if love chooses to save us, and He does, then nothing can stop that except our refusal to love. Even heaven itself is bound by love. For who is more loved by God than his own mother? Mary is so perfectly full of the love of God that she has suffered as no other human being has ever suffered. Her love has been perfected in the furnace of the passion of Jesus Christ. We are also Mary's children. She is our teacher and our protector. She is what we could only hope to be, for she is perfect in the love of God, higher even than all the angels and saints. In other words, those who have recourse to Mary cannot fail, because if love is strong as death, and Mary is so full of the love of God, then nothing can resist Mary. Not even God Himself. Heaven itself is bound by love. Love is strong as death. If we fly to Mary in all our trials, sufferings, temptations, we cannot lose. She cannot be resisted nor overcome, nor denied even by God. Even just one Hail Mary, said with true confidence in this power of love and this power of the Blessed Mother, one Hail Mary can defeat all the powers of hell. A single Hail Mary, said with confidence. God, who came to us once through Mary, will not come to us by any other path except through Mary. So let's go to Mary, and we cannot fail to grow in the love of God. That love reflected in His Sacred Heart. A heart which He took from the flesh of Mary. Love is strong as death. We have nothing to fear, not even death itself, nor hell, nor even our greatest enemy, ourselves, if we will just cling to divine love and call on Mary to know how to love and be loved. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen.